Oh boy.
Shows? Now you don't have to. Simply go to the Google Play Store on your Android phone and download the Z-Talk Radio app. The best part is, it's absolutely free. That's Z-Talk Radio, only found in your Google Play Store on your Android phone. Download it today.
It is time to welcome the person that will guide you through the supernatural realm, your host, Tim Roxbury.
And once again, it's Friday evening right here on the Z Talk Radio Network. Man, this week went so fast. I can't believe it's Friday already. Tonight, I'm going to welcome back Thomas P. Fusco to the show. He's going to talk about science fiction, and he's going to explain how super geometry, I hope I said that right, ties into all that. Thomas Fusco, how are you doing?
Hey! I'm doing great, Jim. Thanks for having me on.
Did you just say Jim?
I told you I would wake up in a few minutes.
Well, you said if I played that song, you would wake up.
Yeah, well. I don't always keep all my promises. So, I'm sorry, Tim.
So, you got any plans for this weekend? It's a holiday weekend. Tomorrow is the 4th of July.
Yes, I know. Well, since I no longer make my own fireworks, it'll probably be pretty quiet here.
Oh, yeah? You used to make your fireworks?
Oh, that was a long time ago, man.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Now you're just not that brave anymore, huh?
Probably, yeah.
So, Tom, yeah. I was watching this clip of a show that was on the History Channel. There's a lot of some of the physicists that, you know, some of the other well-known physicists were explaining about CERN and how science fiction isn't really all that science fiction. They say we're getting closer. We started getting close to reality.
Well, yeah. I mean, there's a lot of things in science fiction that have become science fact or almost science fact. I mean, if we go back to Jules Verne, 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea, you know, Captain Nemo and the Nautilus. He said that the Nautilus was run by the same power that ran the sun. And so it's kind of interesting. And we certainly do have, you know, all the submarines today are nuclear powered. So there's a lot of different things we could look at where science fiction has become science reality. I know there's a lot of things in the Star Trek show that have become reality or near reality. Star Wars, I think there's been a couple TV specials about that. You know, how some of those things could be reality. And some of the things they say are pretty far-fetched. Like the lightsaber, for example. You know, in Star Wars, the way that works and how it functions. They say as of now, that's pretty much a physical impossibility to take a beam of energy and confine it in that way so that it would actually work like that, and it would hit another beam of energy and be like two swords clashing or something like that. We really don't have a way to sustain an energy field like that in that type of a shape. Teleportation is something that you know, mainstream physics feels that they have that might be something in our future, but the technological challenges to it are extremely formidable.
Right.
And of course, you know, in my super geometric theory, I talk about a means of time travel that is not, according to the materialistic conventional physics point of view. And I always talk about paranormal phenomena in respect with certain instances where people actually see apparitions of someone that's been dead a long time. And that information is materializing in local space-time at this current time coordinate, which is the same information that materialized the individual maybe 100 years ago. And so for me, that's living evidence of time travel, at least of information from the past into the future. Gosh, there's all kinds of things. You know, the little disks that in the original Star Trek series that they would slip into the computer. It was an early form of a diskette, you know, floppy disk drive.
Right.
And, you know, foldable phones were kind of modeled a little bit in style after the original Star Trek series communicators.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
So there's a lot of things like that. You know, there was the one show in the original Star Trek series where they had, I don't even remember the name of the of the particular episode. But they had this kind of portal, and there was a librarian, and they had all these different discs that when you put it in the machine, it opened up a doorway to a certain part of that planet's past history. Because the sun was going supernova and the planet was going to be destroyed. So the way that they escaped was that everybody went into the past. And they looked very much like CD-ROMs.
Right.
Which, of course, didn't exist at the time. So, gosh, we could talk at length on things like that. You know, I have to confess, though, since I'm not a big, big fan of science fiction.
Right.
Although I like to watch it, you know, from time to time. I'm not so well versed in it that I can rattle off this movie or that movie in this particular, feature and how that's become reality.
Do you ever watch the show Stargate SG-1?
Yeah, I've seen that before, yeah. Sure.
Is that science fiction? I mean, would that ever become reality, you think?
Well, it's based on this idea that wormholes can be opened up between two locations. A wormhole, which is what's normally understood in popular culture. It's known as a wormhole. But the technical name for it is an Einstein-Rosen bridge.
Right.
And I think they actually mentioned that, amazingly enough, in this Marvel comic movie they did a few years back called Thor, where there was a woman there who was supposedly exploring these kinds of things, researching them. And they actually called it an Einstein-Rosen bridge. Didn't explain what it was. That really would have melded some brains early on. But the idea is that these tunnels can be made between two points in space-time. And they can actually bridge those two places. They could be extremely vast distances away from one another, and that a doorway could be opened from one to the other. It's an extension of the theory of Einstein's theory of relativity.
Right.
And it was originally, the idea was originally explored by Einstein to try to overcome certain challenges with gravity that were hindering him from successfully formulating what was called at the time the unified field theory. And I know a lot of people have heard about that, the unified field theory. Most people probably don't know the details of it. But it's the idea that everything in the universe was at the very beginning a single field that began to split apart and differentiate immediately after the creation. And so what Einstein's efforts were focused on were to take all these elements that we see today, all these forces, and reassemble them into this original field. And mathematically, he kept stumbling on gravity. And so one of the elements that he needed to resolve in order to make this unified field theory work was to come up with a physical structure that was able to generate gravity without any mass present.
Mm-hmm.
massless gravity. Because when the when space-time first expanded at the beginning of the universe, there was this giant field of gravity. And yet there was no mass that existed yet. Which, as you know, we've talked before how deeply that ties in with supergeometric theory.
Right.
But from a materialist point of view, mass is necessary for the existence of gravity. So Einstein realized in order to make this universe a model of his work, he needed to have a structure that would generate gravity without requiring mass. And this was really the root of the formation of this concept of wormholes. The challenges of them, of course, from a science fact point of view, you know, because you see all these like Stargate and Thor and a number of other things. I think they had them in, what was it? They had them in Deep Space Nine, Star Trek Deep Space Nine. I think they had them in Babylon 5, that science fiction series. The problem with it is that you just cannot move mass through it. In other words, the only thing it can travel through an Einstein-Rosen bridge is energy.
Right.
And so since you can't transfer mass through it, you can't have... you know, human beings in spaceships traveling through it. It just doesn't work. The other challenge, because people have done some speculation on this about, well, gee, maybe wormholes can be opened up to another dimension or to a different universe or something like that. And according to the theoretical model, wormholes can only open... They can only bridge two different places in the in the same spatial field, in the same space-time.
Right.
So you can't really have a wormhole connecting to a higher dimension as such, whatever that means. You know, I'm fine to saying to somebody, when you hear somebody talking about higher dimensions or the fifth dimension or something like that, it's a good evidence that they have no idea what they're talking about.
Right.
Because if they did, they wouldn't be so nebulous with it. But, you know, and the idea about other universes is purely speculative. We have no observational evidence that would indicate that any other universe exists other than our own. Right. Regardless to where some of the quantum philosophers try to force that, shoehorn that into materialist thinking. We really have no observations that would indicate that there is such a thing as any other universe other than our own.
Is it?
And it's in spite of what Dr. What was his Cuckoo Kaku? What's his name?
Michio Kaku.
Michio Kaku.
Kaku or something. I don't know.
In spite of what he tries to. You know, to stir the public's imagination with, so you know he could sell more cornflakes for the network.
Yeah, that's exactly what I was explaining to Tom, my neighbor. I said a lot of these so-called physicists and scientists, they're all sensationalists. They tell you what they think without any scientific or mathematical fact. To sell cornflakes to be popular and to sell books.
Yeah, and even and what's his name? Nielsen deGrasse Tyson deGrasse
deGrasse Tyson, yeah.
Yeah, I forget what his name is exactly. I know I've got two out of three correct. It's three names, but he's a bit better. But still I've caught him doing some saying some things that were a little bit whacked out too. And their peers, their fellow scientists, know what makes sense and what's really speculative or, you know, fantastical, so to speak. But these guys are not playing to their fellow scientists. They're playing to the general public. They're playing to the mass audience.
Yeah, do you think these guys even believe their stories themselves, or, you know, like the string theory, you know, and some of the
String theory is something that a lot of scientists like quite a bit. Mm-hmm. It's just that, again, we have a problem with string theory, depending on the version that you look at. You know, one version talks about 10 levels, 10 dimensions. One's 11. Another one is like 22 or 23 dimensions. Problem is that we've never observed anything like that. So string theory is just an attempt to take all the puzzle pieces that we have and assemble them in some sort of a logical system, backed with some mathematics. Mm-hmm. And, you know, string theory is impressive, but it introduces as many problems as it tries to solve. And we have problems where it doesn't really, we don't really have any observations that would indicate that that theory is correct. We just have a construct, and it creates certain anomalies that, like I said, that that we're not able to experimentally demonstrate.
Thomas, could an Einstein-Rosa bridge be the cause of, say, paranormal phenomenon or EVP?
I don't think so. There are those out there who do. I don't think so.
Okay.
Because one of the problems that we run into is, and again, you and I have talked about this multiple times,
yes,
both privately and on the air, that we have two different elements or two different ingredients necessary for a physical materialization. And that's something to be made material, literally, something to be made physical. One of them is an energy of some sort. Everything that we see and hear all has to do with energy compression waves. But the other ingredient is information. It's the actual data from which material objects are structured and formed, even right down to the molecular and subatomic levels. So for paranormal phenomena to occur, one of the things that are necessary for it is a source of information. So we have to first ascertain a reasonable source of information. And if the information is coming from local space, from the same location as the phenomenon is observed, then there's no need for a wormhole. And you and I have talked about this before, about the source of this information can't be local. It can't be coming from local space. There's no material in the living room of a haunted house to store this kind of information that would be necessary to physically manifest a voice or an image or that type of a phenomenon. So if it's not stored locally, it has to be stored somewhere else and is coming into our local space from that other location. Now, if it's a wormhole, that other location has to be another place in this space-time, somewhere in this universe, in this physical universe. And so again, you know, if you're seeing an apparition of dead Aunt Mary, that means somewhere there must be a dead Aunt Mary in this same universe. And the odds of that are virtually impossible. People think about this very superficially, but you have to think of what led to dead Aunt Mary on this earth. The sequence of events from the beginning of time. The beginning of time. I mean, all through the formation of our solar system, and the planet and the earliest forms of life and that evolution of all that life that led all the way up over billions of years to dead Aunt Mary.
Right.
And that would have had to have occurred identically somewhere else in our universe. I mean, the odds of it are to coin a phrase, astronomical. So if the information is coming from outside of our universe, which is what I argue and what other people have argued as well, both philosophers and religious sages and other physicists, then it can't be a wormhole, because according to the, you know, the structure of an Einstein-Rosen bridge, it can only open up to another place in this space-time. It can't proceed out of our universe to somewhere else. So, no, I don't think they're coming from wormholes.
Okay.
I know there's a very prominent person in this field that we know about.
Yeah.
We're both very familiar with that used to claim that. I don't know whether he still does anymore. I think he's kind of stepped back from that a little bit.
Well, that's one of the reasons why I asked that question, because I have seen on that TV show that questions were being asked, and it looked like there was a quote wormhole forming on his equipment.
Mm-hmm.
That's why, you know, I wanted to ask you that question to see what your thoughts were on that.
Now, sure. Now, let's put it this way. If information was coming from outside of our universe,
mm-hmm.
but materializing within our universe, there would be what we would consider an emergence point.
Right.
And that emergence point would have certain physical characteristics to it that could be measured and experienced and even witnessed. And, of course, I talk about that in my book, Behind a Cosmic Veil. I talk about that in my super geometric theory.
Mm-hmm.
But just because we have these outward measurements, observations of something opening up, of something occurring, it doesn't mean what's behind it is a wormhole.
Right.
So, you know.
But there is something happening within local space for that to occur, right?
Well, there are changes in local space, absolutely. They're well recorded.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's all kinds of measurements associated with it. Electromagnetic, we've gotten as far as to look at some of the predictions a supergeometric theory makes, like the emergence of an independent gravitational field, the bending of time itself, the bending of space, all of those things occurring with the emergence of a, of a paranormal event.
Mm-hmm.
What I call the emergence of a differential field bubble. And as you know, I talk about primary and secondary paranormal effects.
Mm-hmm.
The secondary effects are all those changes that we see occurring to the local environment that precede or set about the conditions that are essential for a primary paranormal effect, which is the culmination of the process, the end result of this emerging process, which would be the actual full materialization of information. So we would get an electromagnetic materialization, let's say, of a vocalization that could be picked up on a recorder through electromagnetic induction, because nobody hears it acoustically.
Right.
We can get acoustic voices, what we call disembodied voices, or in recent years, we've talked about AVPs, audible voice phenomenon, or an actual apparition. These things are full materializations of a collection of information that entered into local space from somewhere outside of it. And of course, these effects would be preceded by certain environmental changes that would set about the conditions necessary for that materialization to occur.
Right. Yeah, I've actually caught, you know, pictures of, you know, a couple, two or three pictures of various, what I think is a full body apparition appearing on my camera. I've had numerous photographers, professional photographers, looking at those pictures, and they, you know, they couldn't come up with any logical reason why that image appeared there.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, and I've even gotten EVPs at a local historical site, which tied into the name of the person and what had happened at that location. I think maybe a few weeks ago you have heard some of those EVPs I played.
Yeah, I may have, yes. Yeah, I mean, a lot of things have been going on the last few weeks. For me, I've been working on a very important and big project. It's something that I haven't really made public, and I'm not ready to make public yet. It's not that I'm, you know, going to try to open a wormhole or, you know, discover the first interstellar ship or something like that. It's, you know, or I found a reptilian that's been hiding under my bed for years. Something far more mundane than that, but I've been very preoccupied the last several weeks, let's put it that way. But, you know, and we've talked about this before, and your listeners probably remember that I am not a paranormal investigator.
Right.
I have experienced certain, I hate to use the word psychic phenomena, I hate that. Because it has so much baggage. I like to use parapsychological phenomena. But I've never witnessed anything that occurs in a haunted house. But yet, the overwhelming body of evidence is so compelling that these things actually occur, that I think anybody today that thinks that they just don't exist either is... you know, hiding their head in the sand, or are in hard, hard denial. You know, these things do occur, and all they've right. been occurring for a very long time, and they've been written about for a very long time. As I mentioned, there's paranormal events that are described in the Bible, mm-hmm. or mentioned, ghosts are mentioned a couple times in the Bible. And so these things have been going on for a long time. The question, of course, is what is behind it? What are the mechanics? And to me, you know, of course, supergeometric theory is the first comprehensive theory that has actually explained that in a way that answers all the questions presented to it, plus makes predictions that are experimentally testable. And so that's the, you know, that's why my name has gotten around in the field for the last few years.
Right. Thomas, why hasn't other people discovered that theory or has looked into that theory?
Oh, like, well, other people have looked into it, as we know. Mm-hmm. There's a number of, you know, paranormal researchers and enthusiasts that have been very, very excited about my work, mm-hmm. and have, you know, really looked at it as a, you know, kind of a the first real roadmap for paranormal phenomena.
Right.
You know, as far as other researchers coming to the same conclusion.
Right.
The problem is the differences between one of the differences between my work and what has come before. First of all, in my opinion, all paranormal researchers to date, up until the introduction of my work, have ignored the concept of information. They all talk about energies and waves and spirit energy and psychic energy and you know, moon rock energy and ley line energy. Everything's energy, energy.
Haunted objects.
But completely ignoring the other essential element, which is information.
Right.
Something has to shape, you know, information has to be carried upon that energy in order to have any organized materialization of anything. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, it's just like static on an old TV set when you turn on a channel where there's no broadcast.
Right.
And even that has an order and energy to it, or a an information pattern to it. The other challenge, Tim, has been is that researchers have looked at paranormal phenomena in a box, in isolation. They have researched and examined and theorized about the phenomena themselves. And what I did, I took a completely different approach. I took a cosmological view of this and said, hey, you know, if these things occur, then they're telling us something about the way that the very universe is put together. Because the universe would have to be put together in a way that would allow these things to occur. And since our current models of how the universe is put together do not accommodate the paranormal or give any kind of explanation for paranormal phenomena, then my conclusion was that our current models of how the universe is constructed are either missing something or there's something seriously erroneous. They're either lacking some important element or they've mistaken something. And so that's where I started my work, you know, is how the universe is put together. And that's what's made all the difference. It has just opened up real, tangible explanations and insights into the paranormal that just simply never existed before, you know, before little old me came along.
Thomas, when you tie in scripture from not, you know, from looking, from being on the outside looking in, so to speak.
Did you hear the so to speak?
Yeah.
I think mine's Coca-Cola right here.
But you weren't conditioned to believe a certain way when you researched how everything's put together. You had looked at the scriptures as what they say and what they really mean versus someone who was conditioned to believe in a certain way in
yes.
doctrine.
Yes, and as you know, I am a Christian. Mm-hmm. And I'm a very strong believer in the principles that are expressed in the Bible.
Right.
But I did, you're right, I did approach this with no preconceptions. Mm-hmm. I was not strictly brought up in any Christian denomination. My family was Catholic. My father sent my brother and I to church on Sundays just because he was being a good Catholic father. Mm-hmm. But he himself didn't go to church and he didn't openly practice any kind of a faith. Other than he'd tell me he would say his prayers at bedside at night, but I wasn't there. I didn't see that.
Right.
And so, you know, by the time I was an adult, I mean, I'm fond of saying I didn't know God from a goose and could have cared less. You know, I didn't know any of that stuff. So, yes, when I sat down to read the Bible, I read it just for what it said. Mm-hmm. And I was familiar enough with lots of different kinds of denominational beliefs like Catholicism. And you've got, you know, the Lutherans and the Baptists. And my goodness, I can't even list them all. I can only list a few. anybody goes online and looks, they could find so many of them make your head spin. And they all have different read on things. But I just read what was there, and I discovered that there were a number of elements that I ran into, a number of concepts that were not only completely missed by mainstream Christianity, but were in conflict with a number of important beliefs that are held by various denominations in mainstream Christianity. And there were also some very hidden things that mainstream Christianity today just hasn't considered. Ways of looking at reality that are kind of very spiritual, very deep, very supernatural, but were lost over the centuries. And this is what I talk about that I say my chapter in my book, The Cosmology of the Scriptures. I tell people there's a hidden cosmology there. It's not the one that we're talking about in Genesis, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. And it's a different kind of cosmology. It's about how the universe is actually put together as it exists today. And I call it a cosmology that's been hiding in plain view for centuries. And again, I just happened to be the first guy to put that together and stumble upon it and recognize it for what it was in a time in history, late 20th century, mm-hmm. where we had advanced sufficiently in our scientific understanding and had acquired so many important observations about the local world and the universe at large that enabled me to actually recognize certain things that perhaps could not have been recognized the same way in that book in previous generations. So I'm just one of those, you know, I'm a child of my time. Where I happen to be in the right place at the right time, asking the right questions with the right passion mm-hmm. and burning desire to come up with the answers and enough freaking rebelliousness and orneriness to just, you know, throw everything else out the window for the time being and say, okay, that's what you thought. I'm going to come up with my own way of looking at it. Mm-hmm. Instead of being trapped into those dogmatic traditional beliefs that have shackled all the others that came before me.
Right. And I think your background, not being conditioned, has helped you in your research of how the universe is put together. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and the other thing that helped, and I know that, people look down upon this, let's say, for example, if you saw a strongman contest, mm-hmm. you know, where these guys, they hold back airplanes or trucks with their teeth, and you've seen them.
Yeah.
These guys are just incredibly strong, you know, so they can stand up and say to everybody, hey, I'm this strong. And everybody say, yeah, you know. And they won't, spite them for that or look down upon them for that. But when you talk about how intelligent you are, people get, you know, they feel threatened by that. Mm-hmm. But I have to say, one of the other elements that was essential for me coming upon this was I have a big brain. Mm-hmm. And a big brain is absolutely necessary. If you're going to go down on one of those benches and press 500 pounds, you best have big muscles yeah. and big bones.
Right.
You know, all I've got to do is look at that $500 weight and I'll be at the chiropractor's just looking at it. You know, or the other thing, you know what I say, no amount of positive mental attitude would ever make me a starter in the NBA. You know.
All right.
But what I do have is a big brain. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that a big brain gives you is the ability to hold a very large image of something in your mind, a highly complex and large image in your mind, and hold it there for more than a fleeting second or two, and mix all the pieces around, and put it together and see how all the little parts work while you've got that big picture in your mind. And that was a necessary element too. All these things have to come together, and they did. Like, I truly believe I'm a child of my time.
Yeah, I think so. I would consider you close to a genius, really.
Yeah, I skirted here and there. I used to know this guy said I must be a genius. That was back in my my native home state where we grew a lot of characters. But yeah, I mean, I could talk about this. I don't like to too often, but we're in the subject. When I was in grammar school, I'm old enough that where schools would actually give their students intelligence tests, mm-hmm. IQ tests. There's a lot of schools that don't do that anymore,
right?
Because they're afraid to hurt, little Susie or little Johnny's feelings. Mm-hmm. They don't want to set such a competitive situation like that in a childhood with these very sensitive and delicate minds. Which is kind of stupid because that's exactly what they're going to run into in the real world.
Right.
You're going to apply for a job that 38 other people are applying for. And you think you're going to get the job just because nobody wants to hurt your feelings. You'll be standing in a freaking bread line most of that time.
Yeah, exactly.
But on this particular test, And I don't know whether they use this scale anymore, and various IQ tests have particular scales. Mm-hmm. On this particular scale, 100 was considered average and normal.
Right.
And 135 was considered to be genius. Mm-hmm. And on that particular test, I scored a 187.
Wow.
So this helps too. Mm-hmm. But again, I have to balance this on the other side before people say, oh, that guy's boasting and bragging and blah, blah, blah. Although I'm sure if you knew the grammar school and you were able to look up the school records, you would find it there. I'm not misquoting anything. But at that same token, in that same school, I always flunked phys ed. We actually had physical education back there. I flunked it every year because I could not touch my toes.
Really?
Yeah, I have scoliosis. Hmm. And so somebody with that can't touch their toes right. And they never examined it. They never excused it. They just saw the guy can't touch his toes. He fails.
Jeez.
And when we were kids and how kids get together and they're going to play a ball game. So two sides get together and they all pick, they all pick sides. Mm-hmm. What person they want in their team.
Right.
I was always the last guy to get picked.
I was too.
And half the time I acted as the umpire or the referee or whatever the judge was at the time because these guys didn't want me to play with them. That's how bad I was.
I would even hold my hand up and wave, but I was always the last one. Mm-hmm.
Man, it took me it took me almost into my 20s before I actually learned how to ask a woman out on a date. Mm-hmm. So I could tell you all the kinds of things that I was completely inept that if everybody's listening, I would say 95% of them would say, oh, gosh, I'm not that pathetic. I was pretty pathetic in a lot of different ways. But I did have a big brain that I did have.
Yeah.
And so that really, compensated for a lot of other things and kind of earned my keep and got me through various schools and degrees and all that. And, I had a near photographic memory. So everybody's that particular talent is important. Maybe you don't have to be Einstein, but you got to have a lot more than an average intelligence to get into these kinds of things. Mm-hmm. So all these things came together. And like I said, I've got certain attributes which have helped me. But at the same time, I am a child of my time.
Right.
That had I been born 50 years before, I could never have come up with this. Mm-hmm. I'm a product of my age.
Or do you think you're ahead of your time, Tom?
Well, that's hard to say. I don't really think so. Absolutely not.
Because of your knowledge.
I'm a child of the, right now, you know, I'm a child of the late 20th century.
Mm-hmm.
And I use the term late 20th century loosely. You know, hey, all you have to be is over 1950 and you can say the latter part of the 20th century.
Right.
But, you know, have I seen further than others? Yes,
yeah.
I have. As over the years, since publishing Super Geometry, Behind a Cosmic Veil, I see mainstream physics increasingly going further towards this model of mine.
Mm-hmm.
That the discoveries that they're making are actually validating what I had said previously. So is my work visionary? Absolutely. Is it ahead of my time? In a sense.
Mm-hmm.
I guess in a sense it is.
Yeah.
If you look at what the established mainstream opinion of certain things are, certainly my vision, my work goes beyond that. But that's also part of this time. There are people out there working on things that didn't exist until they were conceived in their mind, and they're still working on them to make them to become reality. Does that make them ahead of their time? I don't know whether I look at it that way. I think they're part of the time. That's, mm-hmm. There's always people that are, you know, pioneering new frontiers,
right.
And that's part of a current time as well.
Mm-hmm. So you see more scientists, more physicists accepting your model and exploring it further?
They're beginning to accept more and more ideas, mm-hmm. that will lead them to this super geometric model.
Okay.
For example, let me give you an example of something. And you know me, part of my theory is contrary to all the ideas, all these cosmological theories from the quantum physics, mm-hmm. perspective, what I call the quantumists, as opposed to the Einsteinian school that I'm in, that I would call the relativists, not socially or politically, but from a scientific point of view. And I stood up against a lot of these ideas. I've stood up against string theory. I've stood up against quantum gravity. I've stood up against the existence of dark matter and dark energy.
Mm-hmm.
That my theory offers better explanations for these things. And slowly but surely, piece by piece by piece, evidence and observations and new ideas are coming into play in the mainstream that are beginning to break apart these kinds of ideas and to discredit them that I've stood against for quite some time, standing alone in the scientific world. You stand up and say there is no such thing as dark matter,
mm-hmm.
among mainstream physicists. You're going to be a pariah. But they're getting there. Now, you know, it's interesting. There's something that was just recently discovered. And this is very complex. I'm going to try to break it down into its simplest way possible. Because let's face it, it's just like when I asked a doctor something recently, a doctor said, look, I can't compress 5 years of medical study on this, my specialty, to explain it to you in 20 minutes or less, or 20 seconds or less.
Right.
But one of the problems with our current cosmology is that we cannot reconcile the models of relativity that describe the macro world, the world at large, perfectly, and the quantum field theory, quantum mechanics, that describes the subatomic world very clearly. These two things do not mix. They describe a different reality. And gravity, once again, becomes the stumbling block. And one of the attempts that have been worked on for several decades to reconcile this are theories of what we call quantum gravity, that how gravity can occur on a quantum level, and how that gravity can emerge as the kind of gravity that we know in a macro universe. One of the things that this is dependent on is what we would call a foamy, like a bubbly foam, or a gritty, or a granular, or a pixely, a pixelated view of space-time, of the continuous spatial field, that it is somehow a gritty or granular or foamy, or like pixelated, mm-hmm. like if you studied a, if you blew up a, you know, a photo, a digital photo, after you got it small enough, what you would see is these little dots, these little pixels. And this has been the predominant view. Now, recently, there has been an observation, a discovery on a satellite that we have up there, where it picked up three high-energy photons, detected them coming from the same direction, just about spontaneously. I mean, literally within a millisecond of one another. Two of them hit the detector simultaneously, and one a millisecond beyond. And what we can conclude from that, first of all, their source was determined to be a gamma burst, a huge gamma burst. It might have been a supernova of something that occurred like 7 billion years ago in the universe. And it's just reaching us. And these photons came from that centralized event, from a localized event. I mean, it didn't come from the, you know, millions of light years across space. It came from a very localized event, like a star exploding. And it traveled 7 billion years. And in a cosmic scale, a detector dish on a satellite is tiny. It's tiny, 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 tiny. You know, it's not even a fly speck. It's on a wall. It's much tinier than that. You know, it's like an electron. You know, it's like looking at a single electron within an entire city. Mm-hmm. Wow. That's how tiny that detector might be on a cosmic scale. And yet it picked up three photons arriving at it simultaneously. Now, if the quantum gravity theories are correct and space is granular, those photons would have been deflected. Mm-hmm. They would have never arrived simultaneously at that detector, that tiny detector in space. So the conclusion is that space-time is smooth. It is a continuous fabric, just like Einstein said it was.
Wow.
So that in an analog picture, so to speak, as opposed to a digital picture, if you kept blowing it up like a photograph and looking at it deeper and deeper and deeper, you would never get to a point where you could see the square pixels like you could in a digital figure, in a digital photograph. It would continue to be smooth and continuous and analog. Which essentially, you know, some physicists believe that because of this experiment, all the work on string theory and quantum gravity that's been done in the last 30 years. They have to throw it out and start from scratch again. Which I looked at that and said, see, I told you so.
Yeah.
I told you so.
Dummies would have listened.
Well, no, they're not dummies. Oh, my gosh, no. These people are so brilliant.
Yeah.
But they're trapped into their materialistic paradigm.
Oh.
And this is what it's all about. This is where I broke free. But didn't travel into this feathery realms.
Right.
Breaking free of this dogma in mainstream physics that says reality is nothing but what is physical.
Right.
It's what we call materialism. Rupert Sheldrake, Dr. Rupert Sheldrake, he echoes my words all the time. He and I don't even know each other.
Oh, yeah.
And if you listen to what he talks about with materialism and you listen to me, I mean, it's like we read the same book.
Huh.
We got it from the same place, whatever. That's why I say I'm a child of my time, so is he. Mm-hmm. You know, it was time for these ideas to begin to come forth. But these people are working with trying to shoehorn all observations in reality into this materialistic paradigm, where everything that's in reality must be physical. There cannot be anything of reality which is beyond what is physical. And this is where they come up with these bizarre ideas.
Why do they...
I'm sorry.
What, do they even believe it themselves? And what do you think is the drive for them to come up with this stuff?
Oh, absolutely. They are firmly entrenched in materialism. As entrenched as a Baptist is entrenched in full immersion baptism.
Wow.
You know, in other words, like if you're a Catholic and you got the sprinkling of water on your forehead, you never really got baptized. that kind of a thing.
Okay.
No, it's a religious belief and they're fully immersed in it. And it's understandable. Materialism has brought us to the place where we are in the world today.
Yeah.
Everything you see, you know, shooting spacecraft to Mars and the computer that's sitting on your desk, all of that is a result of materialism. But unfortunately, there are certain observations in our universe, paranormal phenomena being one, you know, group of data, that materialism cannot explain. We have more effects. You know, you've heard of in physics and science the idea of cause and effect. Mm-hmm. We have more effects that we have observed, and we have causes contained in the same universe to account for those effects. This is why they make up things like dark matter and dark energy, because we have these effects with no physical causes. So they have to imagine a physical cause to maintain the paradigm of materialism. And so this is where they come up with all these bizarre theories. And, you know, none of them, you hear this, well, that's great. Whoa, that sounds wonderful and all this. But none of them, the world of science isn't standing up and saying, Eureka, you finally found the theory of everything. None of these theories have ever met that criteria. Mm-hmm. They all fall short. Every single one of them has tried to discredit Einstein, and none of them have been able to discredit him. He keeps getting verified over and over again, just like this thing I talked about, that Einstein's idea of space was that it was a continuous, smooth fabric. It was not granular like the quantumists believed, and still do. They still cling to it. Oh, that's an anomaly. We'll just figure out another way to describe it. Because they're stuck on it. Otherwise, they cannot explain a theory of everything by using a strictly materialistic model that says all reality is physical. Religious sages for years and sensitives, spiritual people, not just Christians, have always believed that there was a spirit realm that was that lay outside the physical.
Right.
Science doesn't accept the reality of that. But the second you accept that this exists, that there is a non-physical aspect of reality, but you don't go into the feathery realms like everybody else does and throw science out the door, like throwing the baby out with the bathwater. If you accept that there is a non-physical aspect of reality, but you also embrace all the findings of modern science, not necessarily their conclusions or explanations for those findings, but the data, the findings themselves, collect that all together and embrace all of it while embracing a what I call a super geometric or super physical aspect to reality, and having a big enough brain to hold it all together in your head at the same time for more than a fleeting second in order to study the picture and study it for extensive periods of time, then doors begin to open.
Yeah.
And light bulbs begin to go on, and old traditional dogmas begin to just fall away. And this new picture emerges.
And that's what makes your work so much different than everybody else's.
Yes, because I accept what I call a three-state reality, super geometric, quantum, and relative, as opposed to materialists that only, accept quantum and relativity. And I haven't left into the feathery realms.
Right.
Like the philosophers who say to hell with science.
you know?
And, boy, you know me. I've gotten a few of them on interviews. And I've kind of eaten them alive. You know, I've made them look very foolish. I didn't mean to. I got one well-known host pissed off with my explanation that everything is not just energy, and explained it in very great detail using existing data. They had no response. They had no way to overcome that. They realized that I had found their weak point. You know, I found their soft underbelly and stuck a knife in it. You know, and so I'm not popular when it comes to those kinds of things. Trust me, and we've talked about this before, Tim, both privately and on the air. I would make far more money and be far more famous if I used my big brain to contrive fantasies that people would just fall in love with. Look right, that just feel right. Ooh, that makes these feathery things that I believe in sound so true and validates me. You'd see me on TV, man. You know, I'd be making all kinds of flipping money. But that's not what I'm about. And so although I've made quite a few friends and quite a few allies, I've also made some enemies.
Right.
Because I've discredited their beliefs in a very convincing way that they could not logically dispute.
It's sad that they don't, that they got to be that way.
Well, you know, some of this is religion-like. In fact, there was this one host that made an absolute fool of himself trying to discredit me. It's like, oh, no, wait a minute. You're going to try to, you know, outmaneuver and out-debate me? You know, I'm sorry, man. You don't have the ammunition.
Is that the same guy we're talking about where he was, you know, trying to argue with you on Facebook?
Oh, no. I've had a few of those boys. Oh,
okay.
I don't even get them anymore.
Oh, yeah?
You know, no, because, you know, they faded into obscurity. And they also know that, you know, they learned.
Yeah.
They learned. Wait, you know, I was knocking on doors, you know, looking for, you know, I'm going to be a bully. I'm going to knock on doors looking for a man that I can lick and feel good. And then one day they, you know, they knock on a door and they see this ugly face stick out with this giant tattoo on the one side. And they just happen to knock on Mike Tyson's door.
Oh, yeah.
And once they got their face bashed in, They stopped knocking on doors. You know, they ran into Mike Tyson.
Yeah, they weren't so big as like they thought after all.
Because they were used to, you know, battling wits with small potatoes, you know, big fish in a little pond or whatever. And again, folks, I'm not trying to boast. I really aren't. I'm not. I'm really not. But, you know, facts are facts. And like I've said, open question to everybody. Anybody wants to debate these subjects with me, bring it on, man. You know, get a hold of Tim. Get a hold of our host, Tim. Tell him I want to get on the show and debate you on this and that. We'll get together. We'll have a few hours. You know, I'll put on the gloves with you and go 15 rounds if you can make it that long. You know, and sometimes you gotta do that. You do that to get people's attention. It's what I've talked about, you know. You know, people in the alternative fields have for years tried to make these things scientifically relevant. And they call the scientists, please come and play in our arena. You know, please come over here and play with us. You know, the scientists said, wow, what? Are you nuts? You know, I mean, you know, if you could explain to me the 7 to 8 steps, depending on the version of the scientific method, I might even consider it. You know?
Yeah.
These guys don't even know what the scientific method is, most of these guys. Mm-hmm. And what I've done, I've made my mark, you know, at least in the marks I've made in mainstream, by going into their arena and stepping into their court, the science's court, with their rules, with their arena rules and their home field advantage and their home audience, and stepped into their ring and gave them a bloody nose. And that's the way it has to be done.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and then when somebody's licking their wounds, they stop. The truth seekers will stop and say, you know what, this guy's got something. You know, the guys that aren't seeking the truth, I don't care about them because they're not going to be relevant in the end anyway.
Right, exactly.
You know, the people who are not seeking the truth are going to go by the wayside. You know, they're never going to produce anything that's going to make a real difference in the world. Mm-hmm. You know, the truth seekers, though, mm-hmm. will respect you.
Right.
For having given them a bloody nose. Just like a fellow who's, you know, wants to be a prize fighter. He's going to learn from every punch that opponent landed on him. Mm-hmm. If he doesn't, he's not going to last in professional boxing for very long.
Right.
So, you know, it sounds kind of egotistical and rammy of me, but, you know, put the emotions aside for a second and just think about what I'm saying logically.
Mm-hmm.
And pragmatically and practically, and you realize that what I'm talking about, you may not agree with my approach, but it would be difficult for you to discredit the validity of what I'm saying. You may not like it. Oh, I don't like the way that guy said it. All right, I grant it. You know, I have a very rough background, and I was raised by a guy who was a semi-pro boxer and weightlifter. And, you know, was a master sergeant in the Army Air Force during World War II. You know, mean SOB, man. So I have that fight in me. And if you argue, well, that guy's an asshole and he doesn't say it right and I don't like the way he approaches it. All right, I can grant that to you. You know, but talk about the details.
Right.
Because if you're not interested in the argument, in the substance of the argument itself. In other words, if you want to throw stones at the messenger and you're not willing to discuss the message, well, then you've just pretty much rendered yourself irrelevant in an intellectual discussion. You know, if you're going to actually have an intellectual conversation, you have to talk about the message. All right. Put the messenger aside. It's like I recently said from one of these you know, one of the paradrama things that have happened recently. And there's always something stirring up, but there's been a couple big ones in the last, you know, 4 to 6 months. You know, if we were dependent, if the only kind of person who was acceptable and able to make scientific advances that changed the world, the only people that were allowed to do that were perfect human beings, we would still be wandering around the mountains of the old world wearing bear skins, mm-hmm. you know, and hunting animals with stones and sticks.
Yeah. Yeah. We talked about that. I talked about that with Tracy a couple weeks ago. We talked about the nature of humanity. And he said that exact thing. We went from throwing stones to fighting with drones. That's one of some of the things that we talked about last week.
Yes. None of us are perfect.
Right.
We all have flaws. We're all human beings. We're all subject to those same kinds of frailties and imperfections. Mm-hmm. You know, but my, oh my, look at Einstein. You know, he couldn't dress himself correctly. He couldn't even match his shoes or his socks. Mm-hmm. There were, you know, he couldn't even get himself a job.
I know.
I think we talked about that before, where there's still letters on records, you know, of his father writing to different universities, please give my son a job. Mm-hmm. Please don't ever tell him that I wrote this to you.
Right.
You know, he was begging people to give his son a chance because his son was so freaking inept, you know, that he couldn't even get the simplest of things done. And yet he was a genius beyond the vast majority of the human race's ability to even begin to comprehend the extent of that boy's genius.
Yeah.
It was said when he published a theory of relativity, while he was a patent clerk, he published a special theory. Did you know that, folks? That when he published a special theory of relativity and he came out with his famous mass, the most famous formula in the history of humanity, the mass equivalency formula, E equals MC squared. He was a freaking patent clerk that he couldn't get a freaking job in his field that he had a degree on, that he was kind of maybe above average student in school. That is, a lot of his teachers said that he would never amount to anything.
Wow.
Do you guys know that? About old Al? Crazy Al? And here's the other thing, guys. Maybe you guys know that Einstein did finally was awarded the Nobel Prize. But he wasn't awarded it for relativity. Everybody forgot. He was the one who first described the internal structure of an atom. Hmm. Albert Einstein won the Nobel Prize for his model of the atom. This was his work he did before relativity.
Wow.
Holy crap. You know, boy, you know.
Some people need to read their history books, don't they? Mm. Do their research or something.
Yeah, I had a woman a couple days ago posted something. Some idiot had put up some, you know, one of these Facebook things, you know, where they put a picture up that has words on it and, you know, something about, oh, you know, capitalists are, you know, encouraged to make cheap goods while they take all the money and make millions of dollars. And it was just so stupid. And I told people, I said, you know, are you guys old enough to remember what happened in the 60s when we Americans started buying the cheaper Japanese televisions and radios? You know, the cheaper Japanese electronics. When we started buying, I'm a fishing tackle collector. When we started buying the Japanese fishing reels.
Jeez.
and not the American ones. You know, the American companies all went out of business. You know, the first fishing reels, spinning reels that were made in the United States were made by the Lionel Train Company.
Wow, I didn't know that.
Yeah, and for years they were the top ones from the 40s into the mid-50s of the United States manufacturers.
Wow.
We did that. I told them, go home, go into your bathroom, turn on the light, look in the mirror. See that guy? Blame him.
Yeah. It's hard for a lot of people to do, though. They blame other external sources. Really, all they have to do is look inside themselves and see where the real problem is.
Yeah, they it's the 1%.
Mm-hmm.
They blame the 1% for everything.
Oh, yeah.
And the 1% has its faults, but don't you dare think that the 99% doesn't have its faults either. You know, manufacturers, sellers, give the 99% what they want. The 99% tells the manufacturers and the companies what they want by voting with their dollars. Mm-hmm. So we told them, give us crap. As long as it's cheap, give us cheap early and often. And we'll bellyache about it later, but when we're actually voting with our dollars to make the decision to buy, you know, we're going to, vote for the cheap. Yeah. That's what we want. Then we're idiots. Not me, because I have a big brain. But we're idiots, Tim.
Yeah.
And I see these people online crying about the loss of U.S. jobs while they gorge themselves with cheap Chinese merchandise.
Exactly. They were the ones buying the cheap shit and complaining about the jobs here. Yeah. That's a pretty good one.
Because they'll complain more about the $75 pair of shoes as opposed to the Japanese or the Chinese $25 pair of shoes. They'll complain more about that $75 shoe. And if we charge the Chinese enough tariffs to make their shoes as expensive as the $75 shoes, then you'd hear these same idiots yelling and saying, screw U.S. jobs. Give us back our $25 shoes. If they understood that they're paying $75 to support U.S. jobs in that sector, if they ever got it through their freaking pea brains, then they would realize, oh, crap. Oh, screw the U.S. jobs. We want our $25 shoes. Let me tell you something. In today's economy and in today's world, there'd be a lot of kids out there that were going barefoot if it wasn't for the $25 Chinese shoes.
Exactly.
Low tariffs, which are the taxes. This poor woman didn't even know what a tariff was called or who determined such things. You know, she didn't understand what a tariff was and didn't know that they were established by Congress. If she knew what Congress was, she probably would have thought that was a brand of sneakers, too.
Probably.
No, I'm sorry, ma'am. That's Converse, not Congress.
Converse.
low tariffs have traditionally been, through many, many decades of economic analysis, has helped the economies of the countries that have lowered their tariffs.
Right.
And have gotten out of protectionism. And one of the things that they don't understand is specialization. In other words, if we had all U.S. jobs making all U.S. goods that we all consumed, think about the amount of resources and workforce that would be dedicated to making basic necessities, like shirts, like shoes, like clothing, you know,
right.
These kinds of things. That would take a huge part of our workforce and resources and economy to supply those kinds of things. But if we get them cheap from imported sources, we're able to devote our energies towards the things that make us specialties, that make us world leaders, like our technology, our software, our solar panels, those kinds of things. I don't think you see private companies anywhere else in the world building spaceships.
No.
That can actually fly cargo when they don't blow up. Mm-hmm. That can actually fly cargo up to our International Space Station.
Yeah.
Private industries. Where are you going to see that anywhere else in the world?
You're not.
You can't even see the nations, the governments, other places in the world build stuff like that. Except Russia has been at it as long as we have. Mm-hmm. And you can't laugh at SpaceX for the one they recently blew up. Just look at all the stuff that the U.S. and and the Russians blew up.
Yeah, I know.
I mean, can you say Challenger?
Yeah, there were a lot of people that were critical of that. Oh, it blew up. Oh, they didn't realize realize it was a private organization that did it themselves.
You know? Hey, NASA's blown up enough of stuff, my goodness. Know. You ever see the films when they were trying to get the captured V-2 rockets to work?
Yeah. Wow.
You see them where they lift off the launch pad about 10 feet, and then they come back down and blow up, or they shoot off in a direction. And, you know, Germans knew how to fly them, right? Why do you think we got some of those German scientists over here? Could you tell us how this damn thing works? Ah, sure. We work it for you. You know, people have their heads up their butt.
They do. About everything.
A lot of people do.
About everything.
You know, they can't think past their nose. They don't want to.
God forbid people think for themselves, you know.
You know, folks, I'm not trying to make you look foolish. But if you do identify with what I'm saying, if you relate with what I'm saying, then you probably are foolish. If you're insulted by what I'm saying, then you're probably one of the people I'm talking about. Now, that doesn't mean that God didn't give you a brain. God gave everybody a good brain, a damned good brain. Some brains are better than others, but you're certainly smarter than a box of rocks. What you got to do is start using it. Oh, I know it hurts. Ouch. Oh, I thought. I had an original thought in my head. You know, other than, you know, oh gosh, you know, Susie's dress looks too much like mine. I need to go home and change. Or I don't like the freaking keypad on this particular smartphone.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah,
gracious.
Where does he have to change the look of it, right?
Or something, you know. It doesn't fit in my shirt pocket the right way. Somebody ought to fix this. It's the 1% who's at fault. Oh, my goodness. And don't even get me. I like it. You remember the where this 99% and 1% came up with this Occupy movement? Mm-hmm. You know, and they had this, Occupy Central Park or Occupy this place or that place.
Yeah, they had that in Pittsburgh.
And all the freaking bums came out.
Yeah.
Well, I remember this one city. I think it was New York, where they occupied a certain park and something, and some guy in an office building actually held a sign out the window and said, "Occupy a desk. Get a job."
Yeah, I was in Pittsburgh.
Occupy a desk. Holy smokes. You know, and I know that's easier said than done, but folks, you got to use your brains, man. You know? And I love the people on Facebook and other media who sit there and disrespect and talk down about science.
Yeah.
You know, how much they hate science and all that and the establishment as they are typing it out on a computer that was designed by science and was manufactured and marketed to them by the 1%.
These wouldn't have been people in a paranormal community, would it?
Oh, no.
Not them. It
wouldn't be that.
No, they don't do that, do they?
Oh, no. I mean, the paranormal community on a whole is a idyllic picture of cerebral nirvana.
This is why I don't get invited to Paracons.
Right. That's why we say this is why I don't get invited to Paracons to speak.
Or get someone to call in when they're out one.
You know, man, I used to work as a professional musician.
Uh-huh.
And I played trumpet during the disco era. You know, I played in clubs. And one of the last years of Steel Pier, Atlantic City Steel Pier, before they closed it down and renovated it and started doing all the casinos. This was before the casinos. Yes, that's how old I am. We were booked opposite of some people might remember this singer named Al Martino. And my band was booked opposite of it. And we were a local band, local club band. You would be surprised how many people came up asking us for our autographs.
Oh, really?
That they had our latest album.
Wow.
There was even a group that came up and claimed that they were at the airport and saw us come off the plane.
Oh, that's pretty cool.
Yeah, but we weren't there. We didn't fly yet. We were locals.
Wow.
You know, the only recording we had, we did a, the band I was in did a soundtrack, a Dixieland soundtrack for a TV commercial.
Oh, yeah.
And that's as close to a record as we got. Funny, but they had our latest album.
Huh.
We were rock stars. And we didn't even play rock. That's how they billed us, as rock stars. Steel Pier put it on the poster as rock stars.
That's cool.
And we didn't even play rock. We played disco. So funny. You know, there were so many experiences in my life where I just simply lost all respect for, you know, the 99%. Oh, my.
Wow.
Now, you see, Tim, I got on a rant.
Yeah, you did. It's already 8:30.
Yeah, man, I start ranting, dude, and I'm going to get myself in trouble. But, you know, people, wake up. Think. You have a brain. If you believe in God, then believe that God gave you a brain. You know, and it works pretty damn good if you use it.
Yeah.
You know, it's just intellectual laziness is all it is.
Yeah, that's all it is.
You know, that's what it is. It's just looking at things on the surface and drawing conclusions and just, you know. And, you know, in the 99%. You really only know that you're saying something stupid if a 1%er is in a room.
Because
if you're saying what everybody else thinks and says, it sounds great.
That's what they do, though.
Yeah. They you don't say, like the politicians we got? Vote for somebody else.
Yeah. People can't think for themselves. They go with the majority, how someone else thinks, what someone else says. Then they agree with it. Yeah, they can't think for themselves.
It's not that they can't think for themselves, Tim. I won't go that far. I think that's wrong. Yeah, they won't.
They won't.
They
yeah.
choose not to.
Mm-hmm. It's a choice.
They choose to find the easy way around the painful truth, the painful reality. Everybody's trying to run away from the painful reality. You know, because once you ascribe to that reality, once you arrive upon it, first of all, you know the truth about what you yourself are doing. That's pretty scary.
Mm-hmm.
You know, connubial bliss is much easier to deal with.
Yeah.
And then once you know the truth behind what you're doing, then heaven forbid, here we go. Let me lean back on my chair and brace myself. Are you ready, folks? Are you strapped in? Once you know the truth, you have to take responsibility for your own actions. Mm-hmm. And that's where all this comes from. That's where blaming someone else or finding fault with others is the motive. Mm-hmm. Because when you find faults with others, then you make your own faults more acceptable.
Right.
You know, hey, I'm not so much of an idiot because that guy's an idiot too.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so the lowest common denominator is how stupid you could be and still function.
Yeah.
You know, and that's what it is. People don't want to take responsibility.
Yeah, they want to put the blame on somebody else. It's somebody else's fault.
Yes. And as long as you don't know the truth, then you can hold yourself blameless.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you know, if you really had to think about it and dig up the truth, then you couldn't blurt out stupid things anymore.
Mm-hmm.
Then you would have to actually take responsibility. And you would have to realize that that guy in that bathroom mirror is the one that's the cause of 90% of your problems.
Right.
For those who were listening earlier. And for those who are still listening.
for those in chat.
Yeah, that haven't, you know, thrown their computer across the room yet or... Or just simply passed out from the sheer weight of this all.
Yeah.
See, you leave too many gaps, Tim. You leave me too much room to start rattling off and you know, you've let the guests take control of the show.
Oh, that's what it's all about.
Yeah, I know. Oh, boy. But then you have to take responsibility for where this crazy nut takes it.
Hey, they can send hate mail to TRoxbury@zoominternet.net, you know.
There you go.
Send it there, you know.
Well, it could be worse. You could let William Schilling take over your show.
Yeah.
The guy who went to our secret base on Mars to time travel there with Obama.
Yo, yeah. Andrew Bashago, yeah.
That's his partner.
Yeah.
Yeah, him and William Schilling.
And the cat's running for president, too. Imagine that.
Oh, my gosh. Oh, boy.
Anyhow, you about ready for a break, Tom?
What, are we supposed to have gone on break, dude?
Yeah, we're... about an hour, more than an hour and a half into it.
Oh, man. Hey, I'm not selling you any cornflakes, so you better take a break and, you know, play your commercials or whatever the hell it is, or we'll all be off the air.
All right. You are listening to the Supernatural Realm. We'll be right back right after this.
Have loosed the fateful lightning of his terrible swift sword. His truth is marching on. I have seen him in the watchfires of 100 circling camps. They have builded him an altar in the evening dews and damps. His righteous sentence by the dim and flaring lamps. His day is marching on. All glory, hallelujah. Oh, glory, glory, hallelujah. enters, so with you my grace shall deal. Let the hero born of woman crush the serpent with his heel. Since my God is marching on. Shall never call retreat. He is sifting out the hearts of men before his judgment seat. Oh, be swift, my soul, to answer him. Be jubilant, my feet. Our God is marching on. Glory, glory,
listening to Z-Talk Radio Network.
And welcome back to the Supernatural Realm right here on the Z-Talk Radio Network. Thomas, I wanted to play that song because tomorrow is July 4th. And I don't know, man. You think we have, as a society, you think we've gone a little crazy the last week?
Oh, you want to egg me into another rant, don't you?
Maybe a short one.
I saw a picture on Facebook where they showed the ISIS boys wrecking all these, ancient statues.
Yeah, wow.
You know, ISIS is destroying all these statues. Mm-hmm. And I made a comment on it. It says, you know, I thought I saw them doing this over here. Oh, wait, I'm sorry, I apologize. It's the liberals that want to destroy all the statues over here.
Black Lives Matter. Yeah, okay.
You know, I'm sorry, I forgot.
I saw something about ISIS, though, on Facebook. This guy had gone into Walmart, and he ordered a cake.
That's a 99er.
Yeah, he ordered a cake with a rebel flag on it, and there was a saying, I forget what the saying was on it, and he got the cake, and when he opened it, there was a ISIS flag on it instead of the rebel flag.
Oh, my goodness.
And that was, yeah, I saw that, I'm like, wow.
I hadn't heard that.
Yeah, he posted it on Facebook, but he was a little upset.
I try not to look at too much of that.
Yeah, the message.
I'm insulted sometimes by I'm insulted, discouraged, and dismayed sometimes by what shows up in my news feed.
Mm-hmm. It said heritage, not hate. Then he wanted the rebel flag on his cake, and they took it.
You
home,
know, we have gone crazy, and the majority of Americans know that we've gone crazy, but we're all afraid. Because now what you got is the thought police. Mm-hmm. And this has been generated by the liberal agenda. And, you know, all I got to say about that is read a couple books. The Rise and Fall of the Roman Empire. The Rise and Fall of the Third Reich. Read those books.
Huh?
See what happened. You know, read what happened in Russia after the 1917 or 1918 revolution. You know, mm-hmm. Especially in those last two things, and read about the thought police.
What was the title of the second book?
Oh, the rise and fall of the Third Reich.
Okay.
And then read about the Russian, about the rise of communism.
Okay.
Jeez. You know, read Karl Marx's The Communist Manifesto. How many of you have read The Communist Manifesto? Read it. Mm-hmm. And then look around, see what's happening in this country. You think it can't happen here?
I guess it's already starting.
Better think again.
Yeah. Good.
And here's my description of it. This is what I say. And I said this on my radio show earlier this week. I started talking about this. What is the fundamental problem here? Why are these courts coming up with all these crazy rulings over the last several decades? Like the woman who sued McDonald's because she spilled coffee in her lap. That was the big thing, you know, and you're seeing all these crazy things happening. Right. What happened? And we'll say something patriotic for the, you know, 4th of July. Mm-hmm. What does the 4th of July stand for? Does anybody remember that out there? I know some of you do. It was the date that the Declaration of Independence was ratified by the Continental Congress. And was published. And you'll get a lot of people today and say, well, the Declaration of Independence doesn't mean anything legally. It's the Constitution. Because they don't like the words, we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men were created equal.
Yeah.
That they are endowed by their creator with certain inalienable rights. And the thing that seems always shut up the guys to say, well, that doesn't mean anything legal anymore, is to ask them what they thought of Abraham Lincoln. Mm-hmm. Was Abraham Lincoln a great American?
Yeah.
And, you know, almost everybody will agree. Mm-hmm. There'll be a few that won't. You know, there's always a minority of something. There'll be a certain percentage that will be afraid to say that they don't like Abe Lincoln. Abraham Lincoln, one of the most famous speeches in this country that he composed by himself, on a dinner napkin, on a train, going to Gettysburg, where he sat up and gave the Gettysburg Address. And he said, 47 years ago, our fathers brought forth on this continent a new nation, conceived in liberty and dedicated to the principle that all men are created equal. Oh, he said it. Now, what is a score? You know what he means by 40, folks? Some of you do. A score is 20 years. So when he said 47 years ago, he was counting back 87 years. Now look in your history, look it up online, find out what year he spoke the Gettysburg Address, he delivered it, and then count backwards 87 years. Was he talking about the Constitution? No. Was he talking about the Articles of Confederation? I laugh when people say, what the hell is that? Did you know that George Washington felt uncomfortable when he was called the first president of the United States?
Really?
Yeah. You have to read into this. You know? Washington never considered himself the first president of the United States. He considered John Hanson to be the first president of the United States because John Hanson was the first president of Congress assembled under the Articles of Confederation, which ruled this country before the Constitution.
That makes sense.
Yeah. No. It counts back to the Declaration of Independence. Lincoln talked about that as being the founding of the country. Mm-hmm. And he was talking about the Union, you know, or a country, you know, so conceived can long endure. This was a test, this great battle, this great war. So he considered the birth of our nation right there. And he considered those values that were placed in that Declaration of Independence to be of the primary importance, which is why he quoted it. He did not quote the Constitution. He quoted Declaration of Independence. Hmm. That's what we're celebrating tomorrow. Conceived in liberty. And that liberty had nothing to do with thought police. This is why I like oh, here I go. I'm really going to get Donald Trump. I like him.
I do too, actually.
Because he says what he means and he doesn't give a damn what you think.
He says what he means. He means what he says and he doesn't care what the outcome's going to be. He doesn't care if the networks drop him because of something he said about Mexico. He doesn't give a shit. That's how he feels and that's it.
Yeah. He doesn't need their money.
Right. Doesn't need their support or their money. Right.
He's not running around scared with his tail between his legs like all these other politicians are.
Yep.
You know, they have thoughts, they have opinions, they have beliefs, but they're afraid to express them.
Mm-hmm.
And so you get these idiots in office like we got.
Right.
Because we've taught them it's the guy in the mirror again.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you want to know why U.S. jobs went overseas? Look in the mirror.
Look in the mirror. Examine yourself.
You know why there's no such thing as a statesman anymore? That everybody holding these offices is a liar and a corrupted person? Mm-hmm. Look in the mirror.
Yep.
Because when these people become human beings and act human, it's you guys who say, oh, I don't like that guy. Screw him. Right. Hell with him. I want the guy that gives me the lie with the Vaseline.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I want. I want the guy that slips it in and makes it feel comfortable. I don't care whether he's telling the truth. I just care whether it feels good.
Right.
You know. And he doesn't care. And he said something. He says, you know, the majority of Americans know that what I said is right. They understood exactly what I was implying. He wasn't talking about everybody comes from Mexico.
Right.
He wasn't talking about Mexico itself. He was talking about the illegals that are coming across. And he says in there, that country is sending them. That's why Mexico is fighting for these open borders.
Mm-hmm.
Because they want to send us all their derelicts. They want to get them out of there. He was telling the truth.
Mm-hmm.
He may have not phrased it correctly, but I think most people who listened to him knew what he meant.
Right.
And knew what he was saying. But because they're all afraid, because of the liberal thought police, who are the most discriminating and racial people that were out there, you know, they're the most divisive people out there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so you want to look about what liberty, what that 4th of July stands for, you look at a guy like that. And say, yeah, that's the American dream.
Mm-hmm.
And he didn't have to lose his soul like all these other guys to get your vote.
All right.
You're not going to vote for him because he's real. Because he talks like a normal person.
Mm-hmm.
Like a regular guy. You're going to vote for the liar and the cheater and the corrupted individual that long ago has sold their own soul. That's the person you're going to vote for.
Yep.
That's who you're going to vote for. Look in the mirror.
Mm-hmm.
Look about this. They took off the Dukes of Hazzard.
I know.
Reruns because it's got a Confederate flag on the roof. That's your fault, guys.
Yeah, I mean, holy shit. It's getting ridiculous.
That's the 99 fault. There you are. That's stupid. That is stupid. You know?
Yeah, very, very much.
So you want to talk about liberty? I mean, when I was young, we didn't have any of this stuff, man.
Mm-hmm.
If somebody said a stupid remark, we would just look at them and say, hey, you're stupid. That
yeah,
was stupid.
Exactly.
Not like, oh, my God. Now you're going to get fired. You're going to get castigated. Everybody's going to look at you as an outcast because you said something stupid.
You're right.
Before it was just, okay, you're stupid. That guy said something stupid. That's his opinion. Mm-hmm. I got mine, you got yours, he's got his. It's a free country. He can say anything he wants. Those days are gone, man. Yeah, don't you? Look around and see. Look around and see. Mm-hmm. You know? Is this what you want? Sterilization?
Mm-hmm. Mom and I, last year, she had a court appearance because she got a parking ticket because they were street sweeping and she didn't see the sign. And we go to this hearing, and I started voicing my opinion. God forbid, I shouldn't have opened my mouth. But he goes, "Well, I might as well swear you in because I know you have something to say. That's why we have social media, because everybody has something to say." And I'm thinking to myself, asshole, you know, it is freedom of speech. And then when I said what I felt, Mom lost anyway. But at the end, you know, the court hearing was over. And I voiced my opinion again about the drug problems and about the police not doing anything about it. And I heard one of them in the background, whether it was the officer or judge or the district justice or the judge at the hearing, he said, "Keep running your mouth. You know, you're not even allowed to voice your opinion anymore."
Well, I tell people this. One of the biggest lies that goes around is this lie that we have a democracy.
Right. Exactly.
It's a lie. Exactly. You hear the president talk about, I even heard a couple of these liberal Supreme Court judges mm-hmm. talk about our democracy.
Right.
Folks, we don't have a democracy.
It doesn't exist.
Yeah. You remember the Pledge of Allegiance? I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands. You know? What did you play a little while ago? The battle hymn of the democracy?
Yeah.
You played the battle hymn of the republic.
Right.
And what can a republic do that a democracy cannot? Mm-hmm. A republic can protect the 1% from the 99.
Right.
And you guys ever hear of Socrates? Mm-hmm. How did Socrates die? He drank hemlock. What happened? He spoke something very unpopular. He was very outspoken about a war. Against it. And when they lost that war, they were looking for a scapegoat.
Right.
And it was a democracy. It was Greece. So they all got together and the majority ruled that Socrates drink hemlock.
Right.
He was killed by a democratic vote.
If we would have had
there was a republic. I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
I told you were starting me on a ramp.
Yeah, man. We're about out of time, Thomas. But I wanted to play Charlie Daniels, the Pledge of Allegiance, and what those words mean. But unfortunately, we're out of time, so I'm gonna go. I gotta end the show here.
All right, and I'm gonna go eat dinner and satisfy the evil stares from my wife. You're still on that radio show,
Thomas. Real quick, how do people get a hold of your book?
Everybody goes to www.cosmicveil.com, and that's V-E-I-L, cosmicveil as one word, .com. I haven't updated it recently, but there's plenty of stuff there to keep you occupied, and there's links for my book and descriptions of it and where to buy it and all that happy stuff. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you, Thomas. And could you send me your address within the next few days? Because I got paid today and I would like to get a signed copy of your book.
Okay, we'll do it, man.
All right, buddy.
Thanks, Tim.
You're welcome. Thank you, Thomas, right. For coming on.
Okay.
All right.
Good night.
Good night. Well, folks, that was Thomas Pete Fusco on the Supernatural Realm on the Z Talk. We don't know. Unfortunately, it's 9 p.m. Eastern here and I got to hurry up and give this server to Al Warren. You've been listening to the Supernatural Realm. I'm going to have to end the show here and say goodnight and happy 4th of July. And have a great and safe and blessed weekend. Good night, everybody. Up next, Warren Exchange, right here on the Z Talk Radio Network. Good night, everybody. Have a great weekend.